Northern Ireland benefits from being part of the United Kingdom. Its people benefit, its economy benefits. We're part of the fifth largest economy of the world. By contrast, over 100 years of independence for the Republic of Ireland, which leaves it today as the poorest region in the British Isles. So after 100 years of independence, almost 50 years membership of the European Union, the Republic of Ireland as a region of the British Isles remains the poorest region of the British Isles. It has no National Health Service, 11% of its employees are in the public sector. The rest of its economy is essentially a tax haven economy model, which washes through huge amounts of money for US corporations. By contrast, Northern Ireland has significantly higher employment levels. It has a 20% higher standard of living in Northern Ireland versus the Republic of Ireland. We have, of course, the benefits of being part of the welfare state. We have a large, yes, public sector that has cushioned us considerably during the pandemic and which could not be supported by the Republic of Ireland if there was any move whatsoever towards a united Ireland. So Northern Ireland's economic, social future rests surely and squarely with the Union. So for all the talk of Irish unity, the stubborn fact remains, Madam Deputy Speaker, that the Republic of Ireland could not afford Irish unity because the Union offers the people of Northern Ireland so much more. It's important to say that during this year of our centenary, because of the amount of attacks that are placed on the very existence of our country. We had an earlier question in this House today about the State of Israel and how Hamas wishes to wipe it off the map. And as a member of a small state, I get that. I understand that, because there is clearly an agenda to abuse Northern Ireland that it shouldn't really exist. Well, I'm proud it exists, and I'm proud that this Queen's speech actually will help us to continue to grow our economy as being part of this union. That's important to say that. However, so far, the first and second quarters of this year have created significant challenges for Northern Ireland. One of those issues was well beyond the government's control, namely dealing with the pandemic. The second issue was, of course, the Northern Ireland Protocol, which has unfortunately blighted business opportunity for the first two quarters this year. Now, I welcome Lord Frost's comments earlier this week that the protocol is not sustainable. But once again, we need more than just words. We've had lots of words. The Prime Minister told businesses they could bend the protocol. Well, they can't. A Secretary of State told us it would be light touch. It isn't. We now have been told it is not sustainable. Well, if that's the case, I and my country would like to see actions over the unsustainable protocol. It needs to be put away to put businesses out of their misery in Northern Ireland. I urge the government to invoke Article 16 and to make sure that we can move on from the societal and economic hardship that has been caused single-handedly by that protocol. And I hope that we can do that and do that fast. Those who want to keep the protocol for a political point-scoring exercise while businesses suffer, those people and those parties only seek to prove that Northern Ireland is somehow different, without realising that it is that difference that prevents normalisation of both politics and our economy. I hope that we can build on the promises that have been contained in the Queen's speech. I hope we can build on the bus building promises. The government has to do an awful lot to meet the 4,000 predicted buses that they will build during this Parliament, so they really do need to get a move on that one. Thank you.